Hi there, welcome to day 48 of our lockdown diaries. So here I have a cone. It's a carbon fibre cone out of a REL G series subwoofer. Now we were talking about speed the other day. This whole cone, including the rubber roll surround, which as you can see is a very sizable roll, this whole assembly weighs 160 grams. It is absolutely bulletproof, very, very tough carbon fibre, and yet light as a feather, really. And that's what gives the G series that incredible snap and instantaneous response, is the fact that the massive coil on here and the big magnet, which is almost the same size as the actual cone, is just delivering such a fast response. It can respond incredibly fast because it's got a big motor and a very light cone. But also that cone has to be pistonic, has to really move a lot of air. So it's very, very rigid. You can't deform this cone no matter what you try to do. In fact, just before I was considering whether I should stand on this to show how tough it was, but that was going to be a bit hard to film, and I was a bit worried about twisting my ankle if I got off balance, so just being a bit prudent there. So that's one of the big features of what makes speed. We talked about the speed of getting the signal through the amplifier circuit and the filter, and then when we get it to the driver, we want that driver to start and stop instantaneously. If the cone is heavier, it's going to carry on going even after the amplifier has said stop, come back, go the other way. So you want this to be responding really quickly backwards and forwards, and that's what the light cone does. So that's one of the secrets to what REL do. Another thing is carbon fibres are not all equal. If you transport carbon fibre at the wrong temperature, then you add to the mass of it because it absorbs moisture. So when you're forming the cones, you have to be particularly careful that the carbon fibre that they're being made from is transported in a refrigerated state to maintain its properties, and then when it is formed into the shape of the cone, that the correct temperature and pressure and everything is applied. If you don't do that, you will still have a carbon fibre look. It will look like carbon fibre, but the mass will not be as light as when you do everything by the book. So there's a lot of things go into it, and you can tell the good stuff because it sounds better and it lasts longer and it costs more because you get what you pay for. There are no free rides in this business at all. Now, talking about free rides, I was in a store a little while ago and I heard the salesman talking to this person. Now, this wasn't one of my hi-fi dealers, this was a chain store, so I'll just share that with you at the outset. But I was hanging around waiting to see somebody, and I overheard this conversation, and the salesman was telling the person that this amplifier, a home theater amplifier, was capable of putting out 160 watts per channel, all channels driven, 7.1 channel amplifier. I'm doing the maths in my head and going, gee, that's over 1,000 watts of output for all those channels. I wonder how that can be coming out of that small power supply of that amplifier, because I was standing around the other side of this rack and I was looking at the power consumption figure on the back of the amplifier. And after the salesman walked off and went to a different part of the store, I went up and had a closer look, and sure enough, it was 470 watts power consumption. Now, the customer was still browsing around, and he saw me looking at the back of the amplifier, and I said to him, oh, do you want to see how much this amplifier uses? And he said, oh yeah, and I said, 470 watts. And he looked blank. And I said, well, isn't that amazing? You could plug this into your wall and you could actually generate power, because that guy was telling you 160 watts a channel times seven. It's 1,000 watts. And, you know, you're only consuming 470, so you're winning. You actually get more power out than you put in. And then he started to look a bit puzzled, and I said, most amplifiers are about 50% efficient if they're really good, unless they're a switching class D type, when they get up to 90%. But the conventional AB amplifier used in most designs will be at best 50% efficient. So if it's consuming 470 watts at full power, it's only going to be putting out about 230 watts of power to your speakers, divided by 7. Not very much, about 33 watts or something. So there goes the theory about the amplifier actually being a power generator. There's no way it was going to be doing that. However, it got me thinking about how many times specifications are just absolutely pulled out of the sky and they're absolute BS. And this is a classic example of it. So when you're looking for a decent amplifier, the power consumption that it has on the back of it will give you an idea of what power it can deliver, but only if you divide it by 2 to get the 50% efficiency and then the number of channels that it's driving. Then you'll get a better idea of what its actual power output is likely to be. Again, the better power amplifiers have bigger transformers, beefier power supplies, and they weigh more. And guess what? They cost more too. So if you're getting an amplifier that they say is 1,000 watts and it costs you $500, I don't think so. Someone's telling you porky somewhere along the line. Don't believe it. Do your research, smarten up, and you'll get a better sound. So now we're going to whip in the other room and have a listen to some music. Stand by. Okay, we're in the other room now, and this is an album that was one of the first albums I bought many, many years ago. 1973 this came out. It's a double David Bowie album, and it covers all his very early stuff from like about 1966, 67, in that area. Completely different to his later work. In fact, every album of Bowie's was completely different to what came from before. As any fan of David would know, he's never been a man to stick to a formula. He's always gone out and done something different and been a groundbreaker. So have a listen to a track off here.
Look who sits outside. Little me is waiting, standing through the night. When you walk out through your door, I'll wave my flag and shout, ah, beautiful baby, my burning desire started on Sunday. Give me your heart and I'll love you till Tuesday. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. Who's that hiding in the apple tree, clinging to a branch? Special place in the rhubarb fields.
So there we go, something completely different from David Bowie. I think his voice was just so great then. He was so young, of course, and we all lose that tonal purity as we get a bit older, I suppose. But yeah, very, very interesting music, quite different. Little bit of a look now at some Absolute Sound back issues for a bit more nostalgia. Here's a look at a very young Michael Fremer, the analog guru in the USA. Okay, so here on the right is a very young Michael Fremer. This is from about 1984, and he is talking there to the Mobile Fidelity president, who is on the left there, Herb Belkin. So yeah, that goes back a fair way. And here's another one of my beloved cartoons. It's Moments in Mechanical Engineering. Will Galumph invents the pivotal tiller. Looks strangely like a tone arm and cartridge to me. Another gem. Here's another beauty. This is Michael Fremer on the right wearing a disguise that was supplied by Jeff Goggin. And to the left there with Mikey is the late David Manley. So yeah, blast from the past.